I'm going to do three things. We're going to talk very briefly right now, and then we're going to do an activity for just over an hour. And what you're going to do is put into practice what I talked to you about right now. Then when we've finished, we're going to go over the theory all over again with you asking questions so that perhaps some of you will leave understanding it. Okay, what you've got there is a circle, and you've got three sections in that circle. And you've got the universal energy that belongs to the cosmos surrounding us as people. And as you know, physicists know that the energy in the cosmos can actually form systems. So one of the systems that got formed is us, living human systems. Living human systems, although we are very much related to living animal systems. But we have some differences. Okay. The universal energy enters this circle that represents us as systems. Remember, when we're talking about systems, we're not talking about people. We're talking about a series of abstractions that may help us understand ourselves as people, others as people, and collections of people. It may. Now, as some of you know, probably many of you know, learning the theory of living human systems is it takes a while, and it's absolutely not worth it unless you can do some things, see some things, understand some things that you couldn't do without the theory. And that's your litmus paper. At any time, the theory becomes a nuisance and gets in your way and stops helping you be more of a person, then you're wasting your time. On the other hand, if it is worth it, I want to talk to you, to the section in here who is very serious about the theory, because without the theory, there is no practice. What we've done is we've developed a theoretical system which is just an idea. And then we've tracked it down through operational definitions and research so that we've got a series of methods that put it into practice. So those of you who are system-centered practitioners, every time you make an intervention, either to yourself or to your group or to someone else, you're actually testing the validity of the theory and the reliability of the practice. And if it doesn't work, there's something wrong with the theory, there's something wrong with the practice, or you've applied it in a context which doesn't support it. So actually, what I want to say to you is, putting theory into practice is a very serious thing, and it's also a discipline, and it's also a big nuisance. Because once you have accepted a theory, you can't go outside it. It's a little discipline. So everything within the theory is something you can play around with as long as you research it. But if you go outside the theory, you're no longer in the discipline. So it doesn't work. Now, what does work, for some of you, you may be interested in applying the theory to other theories you know. Now, that works. You can see what are the common factors between the theory that you know best and the theory of SCT that you're becoming to know best. So that's also very serious. So what I want to say to you today is, living within the theory, putting the theory into practice, and taking it outside so that it may be useful outside in other theories, is a very serious, dedicated research project. And there are some of you in here who want to do that. Now, there are some of you in here who just want to have fun with it. You want to get the benefits, use it for yourselves, come to conferences, have a good time, come to Thursday night parties, wear a hat, and generally have a very good time. And that is also absolutely legitimate. Okay. As you know, for me, I'm thinking theory most of the time. And you, as you also know, you often don't understand me. Particularly in large group. Okay. What I have up here is a very big circle. And in that circle, there are three regions. And the one that we say is the primary person system is fueled by universal energy and it has energy in the form of the life force. And it's the central life force in all of us. Now, systems survive, develop, transform from simpler to more complex through the process of discriminating and integrating differences. And young life, early life, the beginning of life, takes in similarities rather than differences. So as the system takes in similarities rather than differences, what tends to happen is a subsystem that takes in similarities much more easily than differences. And that is the core system that we develop from our history. The difficulty with that system is that because it doesn't take in differences, it doesn't differentiate very much, and it doesn't develop very much. So if you think about your personalized roles, you will see that they developed from very early and went on. And they don't differ very much. They sort of grow up with you. But the role that one acts out today is very much the same as the role one acted out at 4 or 5 years old. And I just want to remind you all, maladaptive roles, roles that are restraining forces, were once solutions to enable us to relate. And they were the in response to other people who were demanding compromises from us in order to make a relationship with us. So although we hate compromises and we think that our essential selves ought to be good enough, we ought to be good enough just as we are, right? And everybody should absolutely adore us, right? Well, the trouble is that when you actually try to make a relationship, you can only make the relationship that you can make, not the one you want. Because the one you want is a personalized relationship. So we've been struggling with this in large group all 5 days. What does it mean to personalize? Well, what it means to personalize is to come on out from an old role that's redundant. It's the same old, same old. So when you hear yourselves personalizing, you're saying the same thing over and over and over. It's redundant. That's very difficult because it's also the part of you that you know best. If we change languages, it's the difference between primary narcissism, which is the life force in that top segment, and secondary narcissism, which are the roles that we learned in order to get along with other people. So we've got a long way to go in large group because I don't think I made myself clear enough. But actually what we're struggling with when we come on out and personalize and draw everybody's attention to what I think, what I feel, etc., etc., whether or not it's in context, is the secondary relationships we make. Okay, and then worse, we induct others into those same relationships. So pretty well we have roll-offs pretty soon. Now we all do that. We probably all do that predominantly most of the time. And it's an absolute bear to change. It's like everything else in SCT. if you're going to change anything, you have to do it every time so that you develop a competing fork in the road to those neurological pathways that wire together and fire together. So this is where SCT is a real nuisance, because it requires you to keep changing from the neurological pathways that fire automatically and that are addictive. It keeps requiring you to change from those and do something different. And after a little while, one says, oh, for God's sake, give me a break. Okay. Well, when you're in SCT, you don't get a break. Okay. Now, there must be a small or maybe large subgroup in here where it's working. And I'd love to see some hands for anyone that thinks SCT is actually working for them in terms of a change. Oh, good. Oh, my. Well.
Sometimes.
yeah, just take a minute.
Well, that makes me feel wonderful. That really makes me feel wonderful. Okay. So now we've got the relationship between the person system, which has the life force, the redundant system, which gives us an identity. Because we know who we are with all those roles. We don't know who we are with the roles that we're going to develop, because they haven't happened yet. So that identity is also the repetition compulsion, the compulsion to repeat what we know already, which is also natural and human. We want to go safely to what we know already. And there's no other part of us where our development and transformation takes place. So the life force and the redundant personalizing system are the stabilizing part of ourselves. What we are required to do is to transform. And we do that with the other kind of energy we've got, which is the exploratory drive. And with the exploratory drive, we can turn on our researcher role. Okay, so in our primary person system, with the life force, we have curiosity as the major role. In the redundant personalizing system, we have a redundant role. In the emerging person system, we have the exploratory drive and the researcher role. Is that familiar to you?
Yeah.
Okay. So that is what we're going to focus on in our activity today. We're going to cross boundaries. We're going to cross from the person system past into the person system present. We're going to pay attention to a hierarchy. And we're just going to keep crossing boundaries. And I'm going to ask you to pay attention to the experience when you cross the boundary. You don't have long, like you have 5 minutes to do each step. Sometimes you're lucky and you get 10 minutes. And there's only one more thing you have to do, which is you have to pair up. So would you, starting this end, would you make pairs? Come in here and just remind us all that neurobiologically, isn't that right, Susan,
yes.
We are hardwired to look for problems. absolutely hardwired to look and see what might be a problem in the world so that we can avoid it. And because of that hardwiring, we all do negative predictions, which it makes logical sense, doesn't it? And as you know, in SCT, the discipline is to develop alternate wiring, where one stops the negative predictions, knows that one's going to be hardwired for looking for problems, and coming over the other side and testing reality from our researcher. And the difficulty is that that does mean sitting at the edge of the unknown. And I want to link that right now to the large group where we got close to the chaos. Because the issue is that inside all of us is the same chaos that's inside the large group, inside society, inside the world. And that chaos is very difficult to bear if we don't explore it. And we keep making the mistake of thinking that that chaos will engulf us. And actually, sitting at the edge of the unknown means turning on one's curiosity. See, right here. Where is it? Up there. So the curiosity links with the life force. The life force links with the exploratory drive. And then you use whatever particular frame, cognitive frame, that you have to try to understand the world. The one we're using today is system-centered. But there are lots of other cognitive frames. And as long as that frame helps us to understand the world, it's very useful. What SCT is designed to do is to give one a map, which if you lay that map on the unknown, you've got some way of moving through it without losing yourselves. So if you know that every system goes from flight, transition to fight, fight, roll locks, crisis of hatred, intimacy, work, if you know that, you can identify where you are, and you can know that there's an exterior force pulling you along, as well as your interior forces. But you can also remember that wonderful thing, isomorphy, where we are all similar in structure and function, and if we understand any little bit, it's going to apply to everything. So what we were doing right now in surprises and learnings, as you were listening, how many of you were able to apply what was said to yourselves? Yeah. See, it's sort of a miracle, really, isn't it? Really, we're not. We can, if we manage the template, if we manage the structure clearly enough, we can all learn all the time from just about everything that happens. And I want to just end by saying that this particular map may be useful. Now, it doesn't exist in the real world because it's a system which is an abstract, but it's still a map. If we think about, primarily, we are a life force. We're part of the existential energy, and we are a life force. And in that life force, we can't help but being curious. And the only way we can stop ourselves from being curious is by making negative predictions, mind reads, going up to all the nonsense instead of the useful sense of our cognitive functioning. And then we go into the exploratory drive and become a researcher. Once we're a researcher, we can do the other thing, which is we can become a member of our person system. We can research our member system, research ourselves. And then as a member of the person, we can remember the role, goal, and context of ourselves, beginning to get familiar language. And then, as a person as a whole, we are a container for our whole person system. And who we are becomes the norms that we develop of our own functioning. So the norms that we develop inside ourselves define who we're going to be, what our character is going to be. But that person system as a whole is also a member of the context. As you noticed, as you crossed the boundaries, you shifted from one context to another. And each context that you shifted into required a different role. And I thought you did a pretty good job of doing that and noticing that. But if you look back, you shifted into a different role each time, okay? With a different experience in the role, and there was a goal in the context. Now, that was those different little ones that you bounced across the boundaries on were the different system contexts that you went into. Remember the system hierarchy. And also remember isomorphy, because exactly what you had to do to make cross those boundaries and be a system in a different context is exactly what happens all through the hierarchy. So you did different hierarchies. We're now a group as a whole, but the group as a whole is a member of the conference, which is another system. The system is a member of SCTRI, another system, and the structure and the function is similar. So that whatever you learn here, the system as a whole can learn. When we change and understand and alter the norms in the large group, the system as a whole can change. And it's really sort of, for me, a sort of a miracle. And that's it for this conference, and I'm so glad you all came. Thank you.